Të dashur teleshikues të televizionit të shqiptarëve të Amerikës, vazhdojmë bisedën mjaft interesante me kandidatin republikan për partinë republikane në zgjedhjet paraprake në distriktin e 10 këtu në Michigan, me generalin e aviacionit amerikan, zotin Slocum. Do të kemi në studio dhe për të vazhduar bisedën ton me çështje që interesojnë më shumë komunitetit ton dhe pse ne duhet si shqiptar ta zgjedhim atë e të jemi pjesë e votimeve. What I said in Albanian, just two sentences before, I said that in this part we talk about mostly with the interest of the Albanian community, how the Albanians will see in you somebody who express their opinions and their needs, in order they will come and vote for you at the elections that are at the 4th of August.
Yes.
So, President Trump recently announced some changes in the immigration policies towards DACA, the program of DACA that includes the young people coming in young age as children with their parents in United States, and changes at the immigration policy towards immigration with merits. What is your what should be the directions towards helping with immigrations?
Well, great. And I think we talked about it earlier, but to reiterate, you know, some of the greatest patriots I know are first generation immigrants in this country. And it is a country founded on immigration. Let me say, I'm against illegal immigration, emphatically. It's about national sovereignty. It's about national security. It's about public health. We can go on with many, many reasons why we need to focus on legal immigration. And we need to have a robust legal immigration system that supports the patriots like what we were talking about. It's good for the economy. It's good for so much in this country. And it gives us our strength and diversity. But what we need to do is once again go back and uphold the rule of law so that we're not having illegal immigration that's going on, which I think so many folks, when we talk about immigration, get those two...
It's so confused.
Confused, exactly.
Yeah, but I see the most confusion come from the Democrats. They wanted to open the borders for everybody. What you heard recently from Vice President Biden is just supporting a country without borders.
Yeah, which I am totally against. And a lot of times when you start making arguments, people like to go back, you know, and make their statements, oh, you just don't like immigrants. Well, no, not at all. And I'll give you a perfect example. To me, having lived in Arizona for a large portion of my life, flown and defended the border down in Arizona, it is very porous down there right now, the border with Mexico. I very much believe in that we should build a physical barrier, build the wall. And it's not an anti-immigration issue at all. We have finite resources and we need to be able to secure that border. You're not going to do it. You can't put enough people and vehicles and everything else on the border. So putting up a wall, it's an economical way to be able to control our national sovereignty, to control legal immigration in this country. It's humane. Because you're not going to have people wandering in the desert. You're not going to have people getting killed. You're not going to have the smugglers that are going to be working what they're doing, hurting people, human trafficking, and so much else that goes on down on that southern border, and allows us to be able to put the finite resources we have in a few places to have good, proper legal immigration practices in place. And that's good for America. That's good for our economy. And it's a wonderful thing. That is the principle that we're built on as a country, not open borders.
I agree with that, and all the Albanians will agree, but there are issues. Sometimes you need laws of immigration need to be checked. Sometimes it needs to be more human, but not for illegal, but to find ways in order not to lose.
Well, and the first part of your question that you'd asked earlier, you talked about DACA, you talked about what President Trump's doing right now, but the reality is you touched on it. It needs to be handled through the legislative lawmaking process, not through executive orders.
Orders.
So we need to have laws in place that make sense, which means we need the legislature to step up. We need to have that bipartisan agreement and communication to be able to set smart, efficient immigration policy for this country. It can't be done through executive orders to the executive branch of government. That's not the way that we manage this country.
Another very important issue, we are in the middle of the pandemic, and before coming here, we both had masks.
Yes, we did.
So, and we're keeping social distancing, but
yes, we are.
It's better to say physical distance than social distancing. So, a lot of the Albanian businesses are hurt, as all American businesses, from this pandemic. Most of the Albanians have mom and pop restaurants or family restaurants, and they built their business with blood, let's say, and now they are hurt heavy from the pandemic. So, do you see a way for the recovery? Should be a recovery as a V-shape, as they say, or should be more as a U-shape or other shapes?
I don't know what shape it should be necessarily, but I do believe that we need to get our country back to work. The way that we've managed a lot of the rules with the COVID, and especially in the state of Michigan, simply haven't made sense. As an executive, my tasking was to always make data-driven decisions. And I don't know what data you could come up with that would possibly tell you that it's okay that you go to protests or go to riots, but you can't go to church services and practice your religion. That you're allowed to go to a casino, but you can't go to a restaurant. We need to have consistent, common sense, data-driven policies that get our state and our nation back to work. I think we have over-regulated. We've taken a cookie-cutter approach to things, telling everybody do this. How about we tell people what we know as a fact, give guidelines, and let businesses go about their own business. Focus on being able to do what they do and trust them to make some smart decisions and to be able to come up with innovative ways to help solve the COVID crisis that the government can't. The last thing the government's good at is innovating. Business can come up with greater solutions. Let's empower them, let's trust them, and let's get Michigan back to work.
Let's turn in Michigan, let's turn to the governor of Michigan. She has a lot of quarrels, let's say, quotation with the president. But second, you did it help or damage the recovery or the speed of the recovery, the measures taken from the governor Whitmer?
Well, and I think I was just hitting on that, that I think they hurt a lot. We need to focus on keeping this economy going. It's the lifeblood, and it's the foundation for so many other things that go on in this country. We need to get people back to work. We need to not take this cookie cutter approach, and we need to give some common sense. And there hasn't been a whole lot of common sense from what I've seen and what has come across the media or anything else here in Michigan. I gave you some specific examples right now. How is it okay to possibly go out and protest and riot, but we can't go into our churches and worship God together? It's not making sense. It frustrates people, and that's why there's so much discontent and everything right now. Leadership in a crisis, you get out, you tell people what you know, what you don't know, what you need to know, and you come up with a plan. And a plan has clear objectives to it, it has timelines, it's written down, and it has ownership. You pin responsibility on people. You put a rose on them of responsibility and lay that out for the public to see. That's what we've been missing out here, a clear, concise, coherent plan of how to get this economy working again.
When you are in Congress, now I'm saying when you are, okay, you'll be there. So how you can help, because the pandemic is still, we'll have problems, because it should be not a short recovery, should have some time. How do you think you can help with laws and bills to create the atmosphere for growth, for recovery, to have the same situation before this flame?
Okay, well, the federal government's role, I think, is kind of unique, especially in the COVID. There's things the federal government should be doing to coordinate the effort of the state. So we don't have, you know, 50 different efforts going on, that we're being efficient, that we don't have 50 different research projects. Let's coordinate all those things so we're being smart about doing things. The federal government's also in a very unique position to be able to provide a safety net for businesses. And I think that's, you know, what they were setting out to do with the CARE Act when that came out. Mm-hmm. But that's a lot of money, that's a lot of legislation, a lot of rules that were passed in a hurry to be able to do that. And I think we've seen some of the second and third order effects that were not intended. So it was rushed through. I think it was needed. But at the same time, I don't think we vetted it and staffed it the way that we needed to understand that there are some unintended consequences and some big inefficiencies in that. And I'm very concerned about the spending of the government right now, that we're throwing, you know, trillions of dollars around out there right now.
Who'll pay that?
Yeah.
Should be inflation, or we put to other kids?
Exactly. We can print it or we can borrow it. And that's the real options that we have right now. And I'm very concerned about the spending levels we have in Washington, D.C.
You can pause a moment, but it's a big, should be a trillions and trillions of money in debt.
Yeah. And well, and of course, the other part with the legislation needs to focus on the problem. There is so much involved with the CARE Act that has absolutely nothing to do with COVID relief. Pet projects and everything else, or policies that people are trying to get through one way or the other. Let's focus on the problem. Let's keep efficient with it. And let's be accountable to the taxpayers for the money that we're putting in there, that we're spending. That, I think, is we've lost focus on.
So we just, I had a question about that, but you responded. But then to ask, you are on the board of Fisher House of Michigan and National Defense Industrial Association. And you said that you are in the Hall of Fame.
Yeah, well, I'm a member of the Chamber of Commerce. I'm a trustee at Walsh College. I'm involved with a lot of things around the community, and it was getting to know this wonderful community, when I was the commander out there at Selfridge. And I continue that engagement. No matter what goes on, I plan to continue being involved with this wonderful community.
General, the last question.
Uh-oh, the last one. Best for last.
Yeah. Has to do with the Albanian community. And Albanians had a good relation with Congress. Mm-hmm. They're doing their lobbying in order to be helped from the American Congress in resolving some of the issues of our nation, mm-hmm, that is spread in 3 or 4 countries in the Balkans. So we hope that the American Congress will help us. There is, mm-hmm, a caucus, mm-hmm, in Congress, and when you are part, and you will be part of the Congress, do you think to take part in the Albanian caucus, helping Albanians relation with the United States and helping the Albanian democracy in Albania and the Albanian lands in the Balkans?
Oh, absolutely, for a number of reasons. I've spent the majority of my life in an executive capacity, so I'm like the CEO, if you will, of Selfridge. And as a general officer, one of the things you have to realize is you're not a subject matter expert on everything, so you need advice, you need to listen, you need to be able to get information. You can do that by surrounding yourself with smart people, but also by listening to the constituents, listening to people and what they have to say. So listening to the wonderful Albanian constituents that we have in the 10th district through the caucus is a great bipartisan way to do that. That's not a Republican or Democratic issue. It's simply taking care of people. So you bet, to be involved with that caucus, to be able to understand the issues, to be able to talk, you know, how is it that we can improve the relationships between Albanians living in the United States and Albanians and their families, living in Europe and Balkans, and issues like that, political issues, military issues, whatever they happen to be, it's a great conduit of information to be involved. So a long answer to end it with the word yes.
General, last words to the camera, an appeal to the your electors,
okay,
that for the coming elections on the 4th of August.
Yeah, we're just a few days away. Vote. First and foremost is just get out, vote, exercise your rights as citizens here in the United States. And then my shameless plug would be and vote for Doug Slocum for Congress in the 10th District. I appreciate your support.
Yeah, vote for Doug Slocum. Vote for a general who'd be your general in the Congress. Thank you.
Thank you so much and appreciate the opportunity to talk with you this afternoon.
Dashur teleshikues të televizionit të shqiptarëve të Amerikës, ne përfituam nga rasti që kishim mikun tonë, kemi takuar disa herë dhe në aktivitetet shqiptare, generalin Doug Slocum, i cili ishte i pranishëm në studio dhe na foli për projektin e tij, për zgjedhjen e tij si përfaqësues i distriktit të 10 këtu në Michigan për të bërë kongresmeni juaj i arshëm, sidomos në zonën e Macombit ku ka dhe një numër të madh shqiptarësh. Miru ta kofshim në emisionet të tjera dhe suksese.